Thank you. Good morning, everyone. I'd like to thank Carlton Eley and for Victoria Robinson for inviting me to come and participate in the 13th Annual New Partners for Smart Growth. It's an honor and a pleasure to be here. For those of you who are not familiar with Ohkay Owingeh, Ohkay Owingeh is one of the 19 pueblos that exists in the state of New Mexico. And our tribal enrollment is approximately 2,700. Our population is close to 4,000. And our land base is 16,000 acres, one of the smallest land-based tribes in New Mexico. The Pueblo is considered the heart of our tribe. It's a place where we still today practice our culture and our ceremonial dances. And so it's an extremely important area in Ohkay Owingeh. What we could tell is that the buildings are approximately over 700 years old. At one point in time, there was over 200 buildings, and that's where our entire community lived. Today, there only exists 56 buildings. And so what we've learned throughout the years is that when HUD started providing housing across Indian country, families made the decision to move out of their Pueblo homes and move into a more modern home with modern amenities. And so that's what the tribe, throughout the years, we have seen the deterioration that has occurred because of this movement. The tribe has made a decision to make this their highest priority, and that's to rehabilitate the Pueblo. And so we started this project in 2005. We had no documentation of the project, and so we started with an education component. I partnered up with AOS and Atkin Architects. AOS and Atkin Architects, and Jamie Blosser, who was the lead architect at the time. We hired five of our tribal youth to start documenting the Pueblo. And so the architects taught the students how to utilize GIS and GPS equipment. So we now took that and transformed it onto mapping, and were able to develop, and this really set the foundation of the project. We now had layers of mapping of information that was required. In addition to that, we implemented an oral history project where we interviewed 12 of our tribal elders, where they talked about their stories and what it was like to live in the Pueblo and what that meant as children growing up in the Pueblo and what it taught them to be the individuals they are today. And they shared about the community, the cultural values, how strong they were, and seeing today how that has really, to some extent, disappeared. And it has to do with the fact that HUD put us in some, subdivisions, and so we moved away from the community of Pueblo. As we progressed through the project, I realized how extremely difficult and complicating this project was. And so, of course, with the support of our tribal council and approvals, I realized that I needed to pull in groups to help us with this, because we had the cultural aspect, the funding thresholds, the homeowners, the infrastructure. It was a difficult project. And so we created the Ohkay Owingeh Cultural Advisory Team, which is comprised of our highest spiritual leaders. They give the direction and guidance on what needs to occur when anything is discovered in the ground. I then had to work with our realty department because they had no home ownership process to determine ownership. So we developed that. We worked closely with all the homeowners. Our advisory committee we created, which was comprised of homeowners from people that owned homes in the Pueblo, community members, anyone who wanted to participate. Then, of course, it was Atkin Ocean Shade Architects. This was the team that really helped me move the project forward. So there was many, many community meetings, advisory meetings, and we started really trying to define ownership. And what we discovered is we had multiple owners. The way inheritance occurred in our Pueblo is when parents gave away the kitchen to the daughter, the living room to the son, a bedroom to another daughter, so on and so forth. Well, now we have multiple owners. That's a problem. With the funding sources we're utilizing, we had to figure that out. The advisory committee helped us create a selection criteria where we looked at the funding thresholds, looked at the highest priorities on the units to really develop a process that was a fair method of who were the first families going to receive this assistance. And so looking at all of that, the selection criteria developed a ranking system that we applied to the families, and that's how we determined the first 20 that we assisted. Then we had to look at the standards and approval processes. This is where I realized this is an extremely complicating project. And so looking at all the funders that were supporting the project, I really needed them to understand how complicating this project was. I needed their support, their help. So I pulled everybody to the table. That was the State Historical Preservation Office, HUD, the New Mexico Mortgage Finance Authority, our tribal council, of course the Housing Authority, and the rest of my team, and really went into specific detail about this project. And it's not your typical rehab project. We're talking about the sacred space in our community and how that really needed to be handled very carefully. So I was going to need their patience, their cooperation, because I knew I had to meet all the requirements and guidelines, but I needed their help in order for me to be able to do that as well. And so that was really, really key to the project in helping us move forward and bringing everybody to the table to clearly understand the complications of the project. We then incorporated a historic resource inventory where we went into all 56 homes and gathered as much detail as we could and put that onto layers of mapping. And so this is some of the severity conditions that we're dealing with. As you can see, you know, where some of the families had abandoned their homes. There's some families that were living in their homes in parts of it, but in other parts, you know, were really bad. We had all the electrical lines overhead. Tribal Council was very adamant they wanted that to go underground, so we had to deal with the infrastructure as well. So it was really difficult. Here's an aerial photo that gives you an idea of the Pueblo core area. And so right here, this area is the Pueblo. And the yellow parts represent the plazas. That's where we perform our ceremonial dances. And so we have a plaza for every direction, north, south, east, and west. The yellow stretch is an area that is utilized for our feast day. So this helps better understand the Pueblo. So here's a layer of our mapping that was developed so we could tell the frequency of use on the homes. We had multiple layers of all kinds of information that we really needed for this project. I can't show you all of it, just so you have an idea. This historic photo inventory was wonderful. The architects gathered over 400 photos on Ohkay Owingeh across the nation. We have now this inventory. They were able to locate some of those photos and where they were taken with the way the Pueblo exists today, which has been really interesting. Here's the other part that became extremely complicating and difficult, the design and preservation standards with historic buildings. Because we had the state involved due to the funding thresholds, Tribal Council was very upset, did not like the fact that the state was coming in and dictating what we can and cannot do with our Pueblo. But because of the funding sources, we had no choice. So we had to come to a medium of how do we find that balance between the preservation standards and our Ohkay Owingeh cultural values, and really analyze and look at where were their conflicts. How do we deal with that? How do we come to that medium to make everybody happy and incorporate all of that into our preservation plan that the council would approve and the state would approve? So that was many, many multiple meetings, you know, with our tribal council, with the community, with my team, the state, and we finally arrived at a medium where everybody's happy. And through that, we had many discussions in this type of settings where we analyzed and did evaluations for exterior, example, on the exterior walls. This matrix, you can't really see it, but this is the type of information we really analyzed, presented to the council to look at. What do we need to do in terms of exterior walls? Stucco did not work. We saw the problems with that. Do we need to go back to mud plaster? That was the end result, and that's what we've done. And so looking back at older photos, that's what our ancestors did. They applied mud plaster. We didn't have stubble back then. When it came out in the early 60s or whenever that was, it was a really bad product where we learned that the adobe does not breathe with the stubble. And we come to find many years later the impacts of that. We had to go through an adobe repair process because the one thing that was determined up front, we do not want to knock the buildings down. How bad they are, we can save them. This is what our ancestors built. We need to keep what we can, make it better and stronger for future generations. So looking at the adobe repair process, it was the cement was removed, an assessment was done, and looking at the damage. So then we could go in and see what adobes are damaged and how do we repair them. So this just gives you an idea of the adobe stabilization. Same thing with parapets. Back in those late photos, you can see where nothing was really utilized to protect the mud plaster. So today we made the decision to apply install the metal caps to protect the mud plaster. The vigas are these metal posts sticking out.